Hello everyone. So now let's start with beta blockers. Now beta blockers, they will block sympathetic beta receptors. And these beta blockers we will write are of three types. They are known as first generation beta blockers. First generation beta blockers, second generation beta blockers, and third generation beta blockers. Okay. Now let's understand what do you mean by these generations of beta blocker. We'll write first generation beta blockers, they are also known as non-selective beta blockers. Okay. Now remember there are three types of beta receptor, beta 1, beta 2 and beta 3. Non-selective means that they will block all beta 1, beta 2 and beta 3 receptor equally. Okay. Now, second generation beta blocker, we will write, they are also known as cardioselective beta blockers. They are also known as cardioselective beta blockers. Now, why they are known as cardioselective? Because they mainly act on heart, and on heart, we mainly have beta 1 receptor. So, they will be blocking which receptor mainly? They will be blocking beta 1 more than beta 2 and beta 3. Okay. Now, if we go further, we know that first generation and second generation, they are blocking beta 2 receptor. Now, remember, if you block beta 2 receptor, which are present on blood vessels, there will be no vasodilatation. Beta 2 produces vasodilatation. If you block them, they will rather produce vasoconstriction. So these beta blockers, they produce vasoconstriction, okay, because of blockage of beta 2. That is why we have made third generation beta blockers. They have some additional special property. They have some additional special property through which they will rather produce vasodilatation. Okay, so which class of beta blocker are vasodilators? That is third generation beta blocker, and any drug which produces vasodilatation decreases diastolic blood pressure. Okay, so first and second generation beta blocker will increase diastolic BP, while third generation will reduce them. Now let's see first, what are the names of those beta blockers we know? Okay, in first generation, we will write, any beta blocker starting with the word P will be a first generation beta blocker. So we will write propranolol. And you have to remember that all beta blockers, they will end with the word LOL lol. Okay. So let's write other drugs. Pindolol. Pembutolol. Now, apart from this, we will write three more, TNS, Timolol, Nadolol, and Sotalol. Okay, so these are the first generation or non-selective beta blocker. Among second generation, we will write AA, BEM. Or you can make a mnemonic BEAM, B-E-A-M. A for atenolol. Next A for, we will write S-C-butolol, bisoprolol, ismolol, and metoprolol. Metoprolol, okay? Now, third generation beta blockers, we will write, they are vasodilatory, but if we act on beta receptor, they can be both. On the action, depending upon the beta receptor, they can be both non-selective beta blocker or cardioselective beta blocker. Or they are cardioselective beta blocker. So we will write the names carteolol, carvedilol, labetalol, and busindolol. Okay. Among cardioselective, we will write betaxolol, nebivolol, and celiprolol. Okay. So these are the third generation beta blockers. Now we know that the third generation beta blockers, they have additional vasodilatory mechanism. So third generation beta blockers, they have additional vasodilatory property. So let's see about these beta blockers. What additional vasodilatory property do they have? How do they produce vasodilatation? So let's see. So let's classify those additional vasodilatory mechanism. Now the first additional vasodilatory mechanism we will write, that certain beta blockers, they go to the endothelial cell of blood vessel and they cause nitric oxide production. Remember, nitric oxide produces vasodilatation, and we will write the beta blocker as nebivolol and nepradilol. Nebivolol, nepradilol. Now, second point, we will write that certain third generation beta blocker, instead of blocking beta 2, they will act as beta 2 agonist, because beta 2 causes vasodilatation. So the drugs we will write are, the drugs we will write are celiprolol, carteolol, and bopindolol. Can we say that these drugs also have nitric oxide production capability as well? So this is how you will remember. Now the third vasodilatory mechanism, we will write that certain beta blockers, they are also calcium blockers, because calcium is required for vasoconstriction or muscle contraction. If you will inhibit the entry of calcium, the muscles in the blood vessel will not contract. They will produce vasodilatation. Okay. So we will write the names of the drugs as betaxolol, biventolol. For a moment, please write only and only betaxolol. Okay. I'll tell you how to remember. Now, certain beta blocker, they are also alpha 1 blocker. Now remember, alpha 1 receptor produces vasoconstriction. If you will block, it will lead to vasodilatation. So we will write the drugs as alpha 1 blocker, labetalol, busindolol, and nepradilol. Okay. Now we have certain beta blockers which have both action. That means they block calcium also, they block alpha 1 receptor as well. We will write carvedilol and biventolol. Carvedilol, biventolol. And lastly, we have a beta blocker which opens potassium channels, because potassium is present mainly inside the muscles, and if positive charge moves outside the muscle because of opening of potassium channel, the muscle will relax, because the muscle will become hyperpolarized. And there is only one beta blocker which is a potassium channel opener, that is tilisolol. That is tilisolol. Okay. So this is the complete list of third generation beta blockers, and these are their respective vasodilatory mechanism. It's an important classification that you must remember. Okay. Now let's talk about properties of beta blockers. Okay. Let's talk about properties of beta blockers. First, The first beta blocker which was made was propranolol. So propranolol was the first beta blocker to be made, and we will write propranolol is given orally as well as IV. But when propranolol is given orally, when it goes to the liver, it has a very high first pass metabolism. Because of this reason, very low amount of propranolol reaches into the blood. So the oral bioavailability of propranolol is just 26%. So out of 100, only 26 comes into the blood. Okay. Second point, that all beta blockers are racemic mixture of D and L form. Okay, except timolol. Timolol is not a racemic mixture. Third point, we will write beta blockers, they generally decrease HDL level, which is a bad thing, except Busindolol increases HDL level, which is a good thing. Now remember, decrease in HDL level or dyslipidemia is due to blockage of beta 2. It is due to blockage of beta 2. So because of this reason, it is less seen with cardioselective beta blocker, because cardioselective beta blocker, they have less action on beta 2 receptors. Okay. Third point, beta blockers, remember, these beta blockers, we will write, they are, some beta blockers are contraindicated in renal failure because they are excreted out through urine, right? ANS stands for atenolol, nadolol, and sotalol. Okay, so it's a very important question and very commonly asked. Let's move ahead, that certain beta blockers, we will write longest beta blocker. Longest beta blocker is nadolol. And shortest beta blocker, we will write is ismolol. Why? Because ismolol gets rapidly metabolized or degraded in the blood only by an enzyme esterases, which is present in RBCs. Okay, because of this reason, ismolol is only given intravenously, and the half-life of ismolol is just 9 minutes. So the shortest acting beta blocker is ismolol, longest is nadolol. Okay, next point, we'll write beta blocker which open potassium channel. We have already discussed is tilisolol. Beta blocker that block potassium channel is sotalol. Okay, beta blocker which block potassium channel is sotalol. Okay, now let's talk about certain special properties of beta blocker. Special properties of beta blockers. Okay, now the first special property of beta blocker we will write is that certain beta blockers, they have membrane stabilizing property. Now, what do you mean by the word membrane stabilizing property? Let's understand it. Suppose, sir, this is a cell, and in resting state, the cell inside has a negative charge, and outside the cell, we have more of a positive charge. So So the cell membrane in resting state is stable. What destabilizes cell membrane? When this positively charged sodium goes inside the cell, it leads to destabilization of cell membrane. So what do you mean by word membrane stabilizing action? Membrane stabilizing action means that certain beta blockers, they block sodium entry into the cell. Okay, and any drug which blocks sodium entry in the nerves is also known as local anesthetic drug. So certain beta blockers, they have local anesthetic property because they will inhibit entry of sodium inside the nerve cells. Okay, now keeping this thing in mind, where these beta blockers are used, we will write that these beta blockers, they inhibit entry of sodium in myocardium into the muscles of the heart. Because of this reason, these beta blockers are very commonly given as an anti-arrhythmic drug. They are very commonly given in the treatment of arrhythmia when the ventricular muscles are beating more because of entry of sodium. Hence, they are given in cases of atrial fibrillation and ventricular fibrillation. Okay, so these membrane stabilizing action is a very good action in cases of arrhythmias. But we will write that these beta blockers, they inhibit entry of sodium into the nerves also. Because of this reason, they produce local anesthesia. Nerves will not able to carry pain sensation. We will write that these beta blockers are absolutely contraindicated as a topical eye drops. Why they are contraindicated as a topical eye drop? Because in eyes, there are trigeminal nerves which carry pain in cornea. So they cause corneal anesthesia. And any drug which produces corneal anesthesia will remove the painful sensation in the eye. And these drugs, hence, they are absolutely contraindicated in glaucoma. Because in glaucoma, when intraocular pressure increases, patient will seek a doctor when the patient will have pain in the eye. If you will block corneal trigeminal nerves, there will be no pain. The patient will not seek a doctor. Okay. So these drugs, remember, they are used in heart as an antiarrhythmic drug, but they are contraindicated in glaucoma. So those beta blockers which have membrane stabilizing action are used as an antiarrhythmic drug, but not in glaucoma. So the drugs are, we will write PM SLAP. So P for propranolol, metoprolol, sotalol, labetalol, acebutalol, and pentobarbital. So these beta blockers are given as an antiarrhythmic drug, but they are contraindicated in glaucoma. So my question is, would you like to give propranolol in cases of glaucoma? The answer is no, because it will produce corneal anesthesia. Okay, now let's come to the second important point, property, special property of beta blocker. Certain beta blockers, they have intrinsic, sympathomimetic activity. Okay, certain beta blockers, they have intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. That means they increase sympathetic activity. Now let's understand, sir, whenever we say that any drug is a blocker, blocker means antagonist. Remember, antagonists, they produce zero effect. Okay, and antagonist means they will produce zero effect, they will block the receptor. And what about agonist? Full agonist, they will produce maximum response plus one effect. So these beta blocker, can we say they are not complete antagonist? Blocker means antagonist, they are not complete antagonist. They have little bit of intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. That means they little bit produce sympathetic activity. So they are not full agonist, they are not antagonist. So what they are partial agonist. So these beta blockers are also known as partial agonist. Okay. Now remember, full agonist in heart produces tachycardia. And beta blockers, which are antagonists, they produce bradycardia. So my question is, do partial agonist or intrinsic sympathomimetic activity beta blocker, will they produce bradycardia? The answer is no. Will they produce tachycardia? No. So what is the advantage of these beta blockers? That these beta blockers do not produce. They do not produce bradycardia. So which beta blockers do not produce bradycardia? The beta blocker which have intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. Hence they are very safe for heart and they just prevent sympathetic tachycardia. They will not allow tachycardia to happen. So they are very cardiostable. They are good for the heart. They will not produce bradycardia. They will not produce tachycardia as well. Okay. So this is the advantage of beta blockers. But we will write what is the disadvantage. The disadvantage is that these beta blockers are absolutely contraindicated in migraine prophylaxis. Because in migraine prophylaxis, you need an antagonist. You need a very strong antagonist or beta blocker. In migraine prophylaxis, you need to block beta 2 receptor very strongly. Okay? Because we have to produce vasoconstriction. That we will discuss shortly. So let's see what are the beta blockers which have intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. We will write a mnemonic. Beta blocker contain partial agonist activity. Okay, so let's write a mnemonic. Beta blockers, they contain partial agonist activity. So we will write the names of those beta blockers as bopindolol, celiprolol, pindolol, acebutolol, and L-prenolol. And among them, mark bopindolol, pindolol, acebutolol. Bopindolol is nothing, it is a prodrug whose active form is pindolol. So my question from you is, will pindolol produces bradycardia? The answer is no. Will pindolol be used in migraine prophylaxis? Again, the answer is no. Because it has intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. Okay, so this is the complete classification of beta blockers. Now let's talk about the uses of beta blockers and the side effects of beta blocker. So let's talk about first uses of beta blockers. Uses of beta blockers. Now the first use of beta blocker is due to blockage of beta 1 receptor mainly. Now there are certain areas where you need to block beta 1 receptor mainly. And which beta blocker would you like to use in this case? Non-selective beta blocker or cardioselective beta blocker? We will write, in this case we prefer to use cardioselective beta blockers. Why cardioselective beta blocker? Because cardioselective beta blocker, they mainly block beta 1 receptor. So let's see where beta 1 receptor is present. Beta 1 receptor, I told you, was present on heart and kidney. Okay. In kidney, beta 1 receptor increases renin, and increase in renin increases blood pressure. So if you are blocking beta 1, what will happen? Beta blockers are used as an anti-hypertensive drug. Okay. Now, as an antihypertensive drug, remember they are not the drug of choice, they are second line drugs. Okay, earlier they were considered as a drug of choice, but now they are considered as a second line drug. Okay, now let's talk about heart. Now, in heart, beta 1 receptor increases all parameters of heart, heart rate, force of contraction, conduction, etc. Okay, so the first point. Beta blockers, they are the drug of choice in all stimulatory conditions of the heart. Beta blockers are the drug of choice in MI patients. Okay, during and after MI, if you will give beta blockers, it has been seen they decrease myocardial oxygen demand. Why decrease in myocardial oxygen demand? Because now the heart has to function less, and we have seen that there is decrease in reduction in 40% chances of mortality. Okay, we will write beta blockers are the drug of choice for stable angina, same reason. But you will write that beta blockers, they should not be given in vasospastic angina. Why? Because in vasospastic angina, beta blockers, they produce coronary vasoconstriction. Okay, third, we will write beta blockers are the drug of choice for arrhythmias, especially tachycardias, because they decrease heart rate. Because of this reason, beta blockers are contraindicated in bradycardia. Let's say why this bradycardia is occurring. Let's say SA node is not beating properly. SA node is not working properly, 6th sinus syndrome. You can write AV node is not blocking properly, AV node block. In all these conditions, don't give beta blocker. They will further aggravate heart block. Third point, we will write that beta blockers are the drug of choice. They are the drug of choice for chronic heart failure. Okay, and for chronic heart failure, only 3 beta blockers are approved. We will write that is BMC, bisoprolol, metoprolol, and one salt of metoprolol is approved, succinate salt, and carvedilol. Okay, only these 3. Now, why beta blockers are given in CHF? Because they reduce cardiac hypertrophy. Okay, and we will write that beta blockers, they are given when the heart is failing very slowly, chronic heart failure. But you have to remember, they are absolutely contraindicated in acute heart failure. When the heart has failed suddenly, don't give beta blocker. In this case, we rather give beta stimulant or beta agonist like dobutamine or adrenaline. Okay, now beta blockers are also the drug of choice for hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy because they reduce cardiac hypertrophy. They are also given in tetralogy of Fallot. They are also the drug of choice for mitral wall prolapse. Okay, so HOCM, hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, tetralogy of Fallot, mitral wall prolapse. In all these conditions, beta blockers are the drug of choice. So in which heart conditions beta blockers are not used, we will write those. Apart from this, in all heart condition we use beta blocker. So let's make a summary that in which heart conditions beta blockers are not used. Beta blockers are contraindicated in vasospastic angina, acute heart failure, bradycardia, or AV node block. Okay, so in all these conditions, don't give beta blockers. Now, the second use of beta blocker, we will write use because of blockage of beta 1 as well as beta 2 or beta 2 mainly. So here beta 2 is also coming. Can you tell me that which beta blocker has more effect in blocking beta 2 receptor? Cardioselective or non-selective? The answer is, here we will prefer to use non-selective beta blockers. Here we prefer to use non-selective beta blocker like propranolol, timolol, etc. So let's see what are the uses. We'll write a mnemonic where they are used. You'll write 4P GEET. 4P GEET. Okay. The first P is beta blockers. They produce vasoconstriction in brain because of blockage of beta 2. Hence, they are given for prophylaxis of migraine. And for prophylaxis of migraine, we give beta blockers because they produce vasoconstriction in brain. And which beta blocker? The most preferred drug is non-selective beta blocker propranolol and timolol. Okay. Second, they are given to control the symptoms of pheochromocytoma. And the drug of choice is propranolol. Third, performance anxiety. Again, the drug of choice is propranolol. Fourth, portal hypertension. Because they will produce vasoconstriction in portal veins and anastomosis. The drug of choice is propranolol, but you will write for prevention. If there is acute variceal bleeding, that means the portal pressure was so high that the esophageal veins have ruptured and the patient is having hematemesis, you need to give an intravenous vasoconstrictor to dilate, to close these varices or dilated blood vessels. For acute variceal bleeding, you give intravenous octreotide. But for prevention, you give propranolol. Okay. Second, glaucoma. Because in glaucoma, they decrease aqueous humor production. And aqueous humor production is beta 2 mediated. Okay. So remember, here we don't give propranolol. As I have already told you, propranolol produces corneal anesthesia. So here we give topical beta blocker. Like timolol, levobunolol. We will write cartiolol, metipranolol. So these are non-selective beta blockers. Propranolol is not given in glaucoma. We can give one cardioselective beta blocker which is less effective, that is bitaxolol. Okay. Then we will write E for beta blockers are the drug of choice for essential tremors. Essential tremors, drug of choice is propranolol. The reason is, on muscles, we have beta 2 receptor. Beta 2 receptor in muscle causes tremors. Hence, you need to block beta 2 receptor, give propranolol. Okay, it is a drug of choice. Essential tremors are also known as benign tremors. They are also known as familial tremors. And these are the most common type of tremors seen in humans. Okay, but don't confuse this essential tremors with Parkinson's tremor. So beta blockers are not given in Parkinson's tremor. In Parkinson's disease, there are resting tremors. Remember, beta blockers are given in essential tremors, not in Parkinson's tremor. In Parkinson's tremor, we rather give anticholinergic drugs. Okay, here we give anticholinergic drugs. We decrease acetylcholine level. So beta blocker, essential tremor, anticholinergic Parkinson's tremor. Okay. Next, beta blockers are the drug of choice for anxiety-like situation known as akathisia. Beta blockers, and the drug of choice is again propranolol. They are also the drug of choice for thyrotoxicosis. Or thyroid storm, the drug of choice is propranolol. Because propranolol inhibits the cardiac arrhythmias which is seen in hyperthyroidism, so propranolol decreases sympathetic activity and it will protect the heart. Also, propranolol also inhibits peripheral conversion of T4 hormone to its active form T3. Because T3 hormone is the active form, propranolol also inhibits peripheral conversion of T4 hormone into T3. And lastly, we will write propranolol is also the drug of choice for hemangiomas. Hemangiomas are dilated blood vessels on skin. If you will give propranolol or topical timolol, because of beta-2 mediated action, they will produce vasoconstriction and hemangioma will be cured. Okay, so they are also used in hemangiomas. So these are the overall uses of beta blocker, either due to beta-1 mediated action or where we require beta-2 mediated or all beta mediated actions. Okay, now let's talk about the last part, that is side effects of beta blockers. Let's talk about the side effects of beta blockers. Okay, now the first side effect is beta-1 mediated side effect blockage. Beta-1 mediated blockage leads to, on heart, it will lead to bradycardia and AV node block. Because beta-1 receptor is present in SA node and AV node, and if you will block them, SA node will be inhibited, bradycardia, AV node will block. Second point, due to beta-2 blockage. Due to beta-2 blockage, remember, beta-2 mediated blockage causes bronchoconstriction. It will precipitate asthma. Now why? Because in bronchus, beta-2 receptor produces bronchodilation. If you will block beta-2 receptor, it will lead to bronchoconstriction, it will lead to asthma. And a similar disease to asthma, I will write COPD. That is chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Now what about blood vessels? On blood vessel, beta-2 produces vasodilatation. If you will block beta-2, it will lead to vasoconstriction. Blood supply to the vital organs will reduce. Just imagine that already the blood supply to the vital organ was less. Let's call that disease as peripheral vascular disease. Like if there is vasoconstriction in fingers, can we say it is known as Raynaud's phenomena or Raynaud's disease? Beta-2 beta blockers, they cause Raynaud's disease. In coronary artery, vasospastic angina. Okay? Vasospastic. And lastly, beta-2 receptor blockage leads to bad for diabetes. They lead to hyperglycemia and bad for dyslipidemia, because they increase LDL and triglyceride level. Okay, it is more of beta-2 and beta-3 as well. Now the point you have to remember is, we know that there are two types of beta blocker, that is non-selective beta blocker and cardioselective beta blocker. Okay, we know that there are two types of beta blocker. One is non-selective beta blocker, and second one we are having is cardioselective beta blocker. Non-selective beta blocker, they block beta-1 and beta-2. Because of this reason, non-selective beta blocker, they are absolutely contraindicated in cases of bradycardia, in cases of asthma, COPD and peripheral vascular disease. If the patient comes to you the history of any of these disease, non-selective beta blocker like propranolol is absolutely contraindicated. Okay. Now, if you talk about cardioselective beta blocker, Cardioselective beta blocker, they mainly block beta 1. Very less action on beta 2. Because of this reason, they are blocking beta 1 main, less of beta 2. They are absolutely contraindicated in bradycardia and AV nodal block, but they can safely be given in cases of asthma COPD patient, vasospastic angina and Raynaud's disease. Okay, so can we say that all beta blockers are contraindicated in, because they all are blocking beta 1 equally, they all are contraindicated in bradycardia and AV nodal block. All beta blockers are contraindicated in bradycardia and AV nodal block because all beta blockers, they block beta 1 receptor equally. But cardioselective beta blocker, they can be given in patient of asthma COPD and peripheral vascular disease, while non-selective like propranolol should not be given in cases of asthma COPD and peripheral vascular disease patient because it could be life threatening. Okay, now last side effect of beta blocker, propranolol is a lipid soluble drug and it crosses blood brain barrier. When it crosses blood brain barrier, remember, propranolol causes nightmares, daydreaming and seizures. So propranolol is a lipid soluble drug. It crosses blood brain barrier, which may lead to nightmares, daydreaming and seizures. Now, which beta blockers do not enter into our brain? We will write not seen with ANS, atenolol, nadolol, sotalol. Because these beta blockers are water soluble drugs, they do not cross blood brain barrier and they do not produce these effects. Okay. Last point, beta blockers, we will write, they mask the hypoglycemic symptoms of insulin or any other diabetic drug, okay, which is known as hypoglycemic unawareness. Okay, and in bracket we will write except sweating. Now what do you mean by this point? Let's understand this part. It's a very important concept. Suppose, let's see, there is a patient of diabetes who is taking insulin. Suppose he has taken higher dose of insulin. Because of this reason, there is hypoglycemia in the blood. Okay, there is a hypoglycemia. Can we say that less amount of glucose will enter into the brain? It's a good thing or a bad thing? It's a bad thing. Because of this reason, it's an emergency. The brain will start sympathetic stimulation. Sympathetic stimulation occurs when there is some emergency. Now, what sympathetic symptoms will come? On heart, due to beta 1 action, there will be palpitations. On muscles, due to beta 2 action, there will be tremors, which are the symptoms of anxiety. And due to sympathetic cholinergic nerves, there will be sweating. Okay? So suppose there is a patient who has taken insulin, suddenly palpitation, tremors and sweating is occurring. Through this reason, if this abnormal or unpleasant symptoms will come, the patient will come to know that the patient is suffering from hypoglycemia. So these are the symptoms of hypoglycemia. And because of this sudden occurrence of the symptoms of hypoglycemia, these are unpleasant symptoms, the patient will go and eat something. Okay? The patient will go and eat something. The patient will come to know these unpleasant symptoms are coming. That means now I have, my body has gone into hypoglycemia. Now the thing is very simple. If the patient is on propranolol, can we say propranolol block beta 1 receptor and beta 2 receptor? Can we say that these hypoglycemic symptoms will not come and the person will not eat something? So can we say propranolol causes hypoglycemic unawareness? It can prolong the symptoms of hypoglycemia, which can be very dangerous. Okay, now can you tell me which symptoms is not masked by propranolol? The symptom which is not masked by propranolol is sweating. So propranolol does not mask which hypoglycemic symptom? Sweating, because sweating is not due to beta receptor, it is rather due to sympathetic cholinergic nerves. So propranolol does not mask sweating. Okay, so this is all about beta blockers, and this completes your sympatholytic drugs. Okay, so thank you very much.